my good, yeah, cause he's intentional, never failing. I know that all things are working for my good, yeah, cause he's intentional, never failing. All things are working
for my good.
Hey, and it's never failing. All things are working for my good.
He's intentional.
It's never failing. All things are working.
Hey,
I know that all things are working for my good. Yes, they are. Yeah. Working for my good.
All things are working for my good.
All things are working for my good.
Here's why.
He's intentional, yeah, never failing. Sing that out, sing
all things are working for my good.
Cause he's intentional.
He's intentional.
Hey, and he's never failing.
Begin our series of lectures. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, how we thank you and we bless you for the beauty and the brightness of this day. God, we magnify you and we thank you for allowing us to come together now to hear your word and to study. Lead us now and bless the presenter, and we'll declare that thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Tonight, we begin our first series of lectures for this week, and the lecture is entitled Discovering Our Uniqueness in the Body, Mission, Calling, and Gifting. And I'm pleased to present tonight as our facilitator, Elder Jeremiah Chester, pastor of the St. Mark's Church in Huntsville. Can we give him a warm hand of applause, amen, and welcome him tonight for this series of teaching. Welcome, Elder Chester.
Well, good evening. It is good to be here. Thank you so much, Brother McMillan, for your introduction and presentation. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. And I tell you, with all that has happened and all that has taken place in this country and in our world, it's good to be alive. I want to give honor to our president, Pastor Duke, and Vice President Dr. Montgomery, and their cabinet, and to the pastor of this fine church, Pastor Mason. We are thankful for this privilege, this opportunity to stand and to share a few thoughts on tonight. Now, I'm no stranger to this place. I'm looking around, and I'm surrounded by friends and by family, and I'm thankful for the relationships that I have around this room. Many of whom have given me countless opportunities to practice the gift that God has given from their pulpits, from their fellowship halls. And I'm looking around, some even from their tables at their homes. I practice eating. That's a gift that God has given me. And so I'm thankful for whatever way you've contributed to my life. I'm honored to stand in this place. I'm fourth generation. Goes back to my great-grandfather, Reverend Harrison, who pastored the Philadelphia Primitive Baptist Church in Tallahassee, and Zion in Tallahassee, and Mount Zion, and West Palm Beach, and Greater Bethel in Riviera Beach. And so I'm thankful to still be in that lineage and to stand before you. Will you pray with me? God, I thank you tonight for the church that you have called and the church that you have gathered. Thank you for the church that you have established on the rock of confession. Thank you for your people who are gathered near and far, those that are here physically in person and those that are joining virtually. We thank you now. God, I pray that you would open our hearts, our minds to receive what it is you would have for us to share today. I pray that this, your message falls not on stony ground or rocky soil, but that it might be a seed deposited to the hearts of your people so that we might be more faithful to what you're calling us to do and to be in our lives and in the world. And so thank you for this privilege. Thank you for this opportunity. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll be sharing over the next 2 days as well with Pastor Lane of the St. John Church from the idea of discovering our uniqueness. And that's where we will launch off tonight, discovering our uniqueness. I want to begin tonight by making the statement that God has not made a mistake. That you and I were created on purpose and with a purpose and for a purpose. That you and I are not the result of an accident. That you and I are not the result of a coincidence, but our lives is a result of divine providence, that God has made no mistake when God has created us. We are the good of God's creation. It is in the creation account in Genesis that God looked upon what God had made, and God said, "And it is good." I want you to know today that you are the good that God was referring to. You are what the psalmist says, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. That God has made you intentionally and with intention, that God has made us on purpose, for a purpose, and with a purpose. And so God uses as a metaphor the uniqueness of the human body, of the human creation, and he uses this as
a window as a metaphor for us to understand the uniqueness of the church body. In other words, as beautiful and as wonderful as you and I are as creations of God, as individuals of the Almighty, so also are we unique and beautiful and wonderful as local churches. And that's really where I want to spend the bulk of my time on this first lecture. I want to embark on this journey of rediscovering the uniqueness of the local church. Rediscovering the uniqueness of the local church. Why? Because to rediscover how we are made and for what purpose the local church is made allows us as congregations, as pastors, as leaders, to live in the purposes of God. That when we live and operate the way in which God has called us and designed us and purposed us, it leads us to greater levels of effectiveness. So there's three aspects I want to lift up to you today, three areas that I want to hone in on around rediscovering our uniqueness. One is mission. Two is identity. And three is calling. One is mission. Two is identity. Three is calling. And this is the statement that's going to guide my time. I want to be clear that we can rediscover our uniqueness of our congregations when our mission is aligned to God's, when our identity is fully embraced without apology, and when our calling is clear. I'll say it again, that we can rediscover our uniqueness as a congregation when our mission is aligned to God's, when our identity is fully embraced without apology, and thirdly, when our calling is clear. God has and has always had a mission. God's mission is eternal. It has not just started. It has not changed, nor will it conclude with us. God has and has always had a mission. And so as a congregation, we don't determine our mission. Our mission has been given to us. God has given us the mission for the church. And scripture, really, the whole of scripture is an invitation for people to participate in the mission of God that's already going on. God has given us a mission. I mean, we see this in the choosing of Israel. We see that from the choice of Israel to the coming of the Messiah in Jesus Christ, that everything that God has done has been to include us in the mission of God. That Israel is shining a light to the world that their God is alive, that their God is not many, their God is one, and God wants to include the world in the mission of God that takes place in Israel. We see this furthermore in the teaching of Jesus Christ, that when Jesus comes, his job is to teach and to remind people of the continuity between the Judaic faith and what he is reestablishing. This is why Jesus clarifies it. He says, I'm not starting anything new. Jesus says, I'm fulfilling what has always been. And the mission of Jesus is to reorient the people who had fallen in love with systematized religion. These religious leaders who, in the name of God, began to create systems and procedures that were void of the very presence of God that they voiced and had claimed, so much so that when God visited them in the incarnation in Jesus Christ, they did not recognize the God that they were waiting on. They rejected the one in which they were waiting for. Why? Because the religious people had lost sight of their mission. And so Jesus takes every opportunity to reestablish and to remind them of what their mission was. Now, I won't bother this, but I think it is interesting to just note how Jesus chooses to reform the people and to engage them in mission. I think it's interesting. I won't stay here long. That Jesus does not become one of the religious elite. That Jesus does not engage in much debate in their synagogues. That Jesus does not seek their approval or their permission. That Jesus does not run for elected office. That Jesus does not allow them to sit him in the chair in the public square. That Jesus's method for reforming and reminding people of the mission was to gather willing vessels, to gather those who were ready to be followers and disciples, and he allows them to live with him on mission no matter what the cost. Jesus does not do what's politically expedient. Jesus does what the Father wills. Jesus invites people to live a life on mission. Notice what Jesus says. Jesus says to his disciples, he says, as the Father sent me, so I'm sending you. Notice what he's doing. Jesus says, I'm reminding you of your mission, that your mission to the world is my mission to you, that as the Father has sent me, this word mission is the sending, as God has sent me, as the Father has sent me on mission to you, I am also sending you on mission to the world. In other words, if you want to know your mission, our mission is the mission of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ has three aspects of the mission. Number one, Jesus Christ, he has a mission to the lost. Notice what he says. He says, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save those who are lost. Who are the lost? The lost is simply anyone who does not know or who has not embraced the mission of God. They are lost because it is the mission that gives direction to and for our lives. And if you don't know, or if you're not part of the mission, your life is without direction. Your life is without purpose. And so part of what it means to be the church is to partake in God's mission. It is to evangelize the lost. There are some lost people in the world, but there are also some lost people in our churches. I said there's some lost people in the world, but there's also some lost people in our churches, because you can be a member of the church, but if you're not a part of the mission of God, if you don't know the mission, if you're not active in the mission, we are still lost. This is what the parable of the lost son reminds us. It reminds us that yes, there are some who are younger and wayward and prodigals who are lost, but sometimes it's not the young ones, it's not the wayward ones, it's not the prodigals. Sometimes it's the older. Sometimes it's the mature. Sometimes it's the convention going. Sometimes it's the ordained saints who are part of the church but who are really lost. And so God has given the church a mission for the lost, and the lost need salvation. The Son of Man comes to seek and save those who are lost. We have a mission for the lost. The lost needs salvation, but we also have a mission, beloved, for the left out. We got a mission for the lost, but we also have a mission for the left out. No, notice when you look at the ministry of Jesus, Jesus's ministry could be summed up as a ministry of inclusion. And I know this word can be controversial, but this stands in stark contrast to the religious elite of his day, who when Jesus sees them, they are practicing the ministry of exclusion. They are excluding people based on ceremonial laws. They are excluding people based on biased judgment. They are excluding people on their prejudiced opinion. But at every opportunity, Jesus includes who others have excluded. Now, I would suggest that this is no mistake. We can see this even in how Jesus picks his disciples, that Jesus doesn't go to the synagogue to pick his disciples. The Bible says that Jesus picks them from the margin. Jesus includes people like fishermen. Jesus includes people like tax collectors. Jesus is summing up those who have been excluded, and his ministry is to include this. And so the continuity is between the Old Testament ethic of hospitality and the New Testament ethic of radical inclusion, that the job of the church is to bring together, to bring in the same people the world has pushed out. We've got a mission to the lost, because the lost need salvation. But we have a mission to welcome the stranger. We have a mission to the left out, because the left out need a safe haven. They need to understand that our churches are the place that's looking and waiting for them to be a part of their ministry. The church ought not be a place where the excluded are excluded. The church ought to be the place where the excluded of the world are included in the ministry of God. We've got a mission for the lost. The lost need salvation. We've got a mission for the left out. The left out need a safe haven, but we also have a mission for the least of these. This is what Jesus says. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he anointed me to bring good news to the poor, proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free." Jesus says, I've got a ministry to the vulnerable, to the poor, to the disenfranchised, to the marginalized. Jesus says, I'm concerned about the least of these. And what do the least of these need? The least of these need a church who's concerned with social justice. We don't just need to shout people's troubles over. We don't need to just have a hallelujah good time and send people back to the very margins from which they came. No, the least of these need some social justice. They need social advocacy. This is the mission. I'm moving. The mission is for the lost. They need salvation. The mission is for the left out. They need a safe haven. The mission is for the least of these. They need social justice. And every church ought to be involved in those three things. I don't care if it's a black church, a white church, a big church, a small church. We don't dictate our mission. We're given our mission. We have to adopt the concerns that Jesus Christ had. And Jesus Christ had a mission to the lost, a mission to the left out, a mission to the least of these. We can rediscover our uniqueness by aligning our mission with God's mission. Number two, we can rediscover our mission when our identity is fully embraced without apology. Identity is fully embraced without apology. It's sad that we have black churches that don't want to be black. And it makes sense. It makes sense because we've got black people that don't want to be black. And there has been too often a rejection of our identity. We come from a rich legacy. We come from a deep spiritual faith. Robert London Smith talks about the historical Black universe, these themes that Black people in America have to wrestle and deal with that creates their unique identity in response to the specific American and Christianized segregation and racism. That the Black church has a peculiar identity. And I think, beloved, that we need to learn how to embrace our Black identity without apology. I mean, in some areas, to even talk about Black church, people get nervous. That they want us to erase every qualifier of our identity. They want us to just be the church without concern of our color. Sometimes in a way rejecting our Blackness. But when you reject your Blackness, you are also rejecting your uniqueness. That God has made us on purpose, for a purpose, with a purpose, and the melanin in our skin is a part of the good that God has made us, and we ought to be Black without apology.
There are two obstacles, I believe, that serve as barriers of us embracing our uniqueness. Number one, it's whiteness. It's whiteness. And I want to caution us about an often silent but prevalent infatuation with whatever is white. That some of us have such an infatuation with whatever is white that we also have an implicit disdain for whatever is Black. And first of all, by white, I mean two things. First of all, when I talk about whiteness, I'm talking about white theology. Now, there's been a lot of work lately about white theology in Black spaces. This includes white evangelicalism, white fundamentalism, white nationalism. And very quickly, white theology is not white because it comes from white people. White theology is white because it privileges white bodies and white concerns. White theology is white because at the end of the day, it protects and supports the racist aims of the white world. White theology is white theology because it promotes ever so gently sometimes and ever so evidently other times the use of the biblical texts and religious ideas that however subtle to us are used as tools of subjugation and domination for continued generations of white people to look down on Black people. White theology is not white because of white people. White theology is white because of its whiteness and its support of white power and white supremacy. And so when we reject white theology, we're not rejecting white people, we're rejecting the power of whiteness. It is a rejection of the domestication of brown-skinned Jesus from Nazareth. We're saying that's the Jesus that we have in the scripture. We don't have a blue-eyed, blonde-haired Jesus. We have a colored Jesus. The rejection of whiteness is the rejection of this colorblind ideology that has crept in the church where we say we don't see color. Well, you don't see what God has made. That I don't have to ignore the melanin in my skin to be accepted by God. God has made me on purpose, for a purpose, and with a purpose. And we got to be careful. Because the mission is for everybody. But identity is different. And we got to be careful not to reject our identity
feeling like we can only accept the mission of God when we reject the identity of blackness. We got to be careful that our black churches are not intermediaries for white theology and tools for white supremacy. That's why some white denominations won't give every black church money. I'll keep moving. Because so often, white theology has been equated with right theology. That white theology has been seen as orthodox. And the inverse is this, that the consequence is that we have labeled anything black as heretical. Listen, black theology did not begin with James Cone or the Otis Roberts. Black theology emerged from the hush harbors. It emerged from the praxis of enslaved Africans who had to wrestle with the God of the scripture that they heard about versus the God of their masters who enslaved them. Black theology did not start in the 60s. It started with the embracing of a loving God by ancestors who barely knew how to read. It didn't start in the 60s. It also didn't end in the 60s. Black theology extends to womanist theologies, to even Black Lives Matter theology. It emerges from everyday Black churches who are responding to the needs of their community in a way that only their Blackness can. We got to be careful by our full embrace of white theology. The second obstacle is not just white theology. It's also white bodies. White bodies. Let me be clear. I'm not against multicultural churches. There's some contexts that support multicultural churches. But I want to caution us against becoming white or anti-black in order to attract people to our churches. If you have to strip yourself of the roots of your identity to attract white people to your churches, we must ask, is it worth it? See, a multicultural church has to be able to embrace multicultures, many cultures, more than one cultures. But many times, multicultural churches are really unicultural churches. Multicultural churches are multiracial cultures with one white overriding culture that seeks to destroy blackness and replace it with whiteness. We can't be enamored so much with the approval and the acceptance of white people that will do everything for white bodies, while also ignoring the suffering of black bodies in our communities. By ignoring the health disparities of black women who are dying at ever increasing faster rates because of the color of their skin. We can't ignore the disparities and the educational obstacles that black children must overcome in our school system. We cannot ignore the prison industrial complex where they see black men and black women and they build more jail cells. We can't ignore the plight of black bodies for the acceptance of white. Because God has made us on purpose, for a purpose, with a purpose. And our identity, our blackness, is a part of the good that God has made us. First thing I told you was that whiteness gets in the way. But there's something else that gets in the way. Whiteness, it gets in the way of us embracing our identity. But beloved, there's another thing. Second thing that gets in the way is tradition. That many of our churches have not embraced who God has called them to be because of whiteness, but many, maybe even more, have not embraced their uniqueness because of tradition. Listen, there's two types of traditions. There's meaningful tradition and minute tradition. Meaningful traditions are those which are in line with our mission. They are concerned about the lost, the left out, the least of these. Some traditions help us to embrace our mission. But our tradition is not our mission. Some traditions help us to embrace our mission. But our traditions are not our mission. Don't forsake the mission in defense of a tradition. Meaningful traditions help us to refocus, and it reminds us of what our mission really is. This is what Jesus says. Jesus gives us a tradition. He hands over something to us. He says, "Do this in remembrance of me. This is my body broken for you on Calvary. Eat ye all of it. This is my blood given to you for the remission of your sin. Drink you all of it." This is a tradition given. Communion is not the mission, but communion is a reminder of the purpose and the mission of Jesus Christ. It is a tradition that allows us to refocus and be reminded about the mission of God. Some traditions point to the mission, but not every tradition. There are some traditions in our churches that don't point to the mission, it points to us. There are some traditions in our churches that are more about our preference than God's mission in the church. And sometimes we defend those traditions more than we defend the mission. If we want to embrace our uniqueness, we've got to be willing to reevaluate every tradition of the church. There is no tradition that is off limits of revaluation, because an evaluation either leads to reformation or it ought to lead to elimination. And there's some stuff we should have eliminated a long time ago. I'm going to get in trouble, but I'm here. Listen. Sunday school. You know how Sunday school began? Sunday school was started as a way of catechizing black children, slave children. By this, I mean that Sunday school was the mechanism by which white slave masters were to teach their slaves how to behave and to accept the subservient position as designed and destined by God. To the point that even across the line in Alabama, that the first catechisms published in Alabama by Baptists were not written for the spiritual development of white people, but rather for the catechism of black slaves. But black people, we saw what the enemy meant for evil, and in it we saw an opportunity. We saw it as an opportunity to be exposed to scripture. We saw it as an opportunity to spend some time learning how to read without the judgment of them taking our books. We saw, even in their biased teaching of scripture, we saw them as an opportunity to access books and literature. And so what we developed in our tradition of Sunday school was a way of learning the word of God. We developed develop a tradition of teaching literacy. So where people would not get the attention in the public school, they came to Sunday school. And Sunday school teacher said, read it again, sound it out, say it again. We use Sunday school as a way of organizing people around the mission of God. Sunday school is a tradition that can be used for the overall mission of God. The tradition of Sunday school is the tradition of Black religious education and resistance. But for some of us, Sunday school has become nothing but a minute tradition. It has lost the meaning that was tied to its mission. And in many churches, Sunday school is a church within a church. I'm going back home. I said, in many places, Sunday school teachers and the Sunday school department sometimes are the very modern day Pharisees of the church, who are opposed to anything new, who are opposed to anything different, because they have a tradition that they received and have passed on, but have not reevaluated the effectiveness of it. So we'll rather have Sunday school when nobody shows up, when no generation is being reached. We'll keep the Sunday school when it has passed its relevance, at the same time dismissing the real tradition of Black religious education, Black social action, and Black congregational care. I'm not against Sunday school, but even Sunday school has to be reevaluated and tied to the mission of the church. We discover our uniqueness when we recover what it means to be Black churches. Listen, I'll move to my third point. Before I go there, do you have a theology that addresses what it means to be Black and Christian in America? Does your church talk about Blackness in a way that your people can hear it and understand that they were made by God and they're not a mistake? Do you read scripture in a way that biblically and programmatically supports Black liberation for all Black people, not just Black men, but also Black women, not just Black adults, but also Black children, not just those who are seen to be the in crowd of the church, but even those who are on the margins of society? Do you address in your church the issues that systemically and systematically affect your congregants the most? I'm talking about politically and socially and economically and spiritually. God has made us Black. And until we embrace it without apology, we're rejecting our identity. We can rediscover our uniqueness when our mission is aligned to God. God's mission is to the lost. They need salvation. It's to the left out. They need a safe haven. It's to the least of these. The least of these need social justice. We embrace our uniqueness when identity is fully embraced without apology. And then finally, we rediscover our uniqueness when our calling is clear. when I call in, it's clear. To be honest, this is where I've been trying to get to. Because mission and identity helps to lead to the clarity of a call. And individually, each of us has a specific call from God. That tied to God's mission and your identity emerges a specific call from God. That God has something he's calling you to do in line with God's mission and your identity. In other words, there's something you can do like nobody else can because you are who nobody else is. This is what he tells Jeremiah. He says, before I formed you in the womb of your mother, I knew you. And not only did I know you, I sanctified you. I set you apart to be, here's the call, a prophet to the nations. That you cannot be who I purposed and called you to be if you are not who I have made you to be. Your mission and your identity is tied to your calling. And some of us have missed our calling because we have rejected the mission and our identity. I wish I had time to talk about even your experiences. That there are some things that you have gone through that adds clarity to your call. There are some things that God uses in your life that you've experienced because God is clarifying your mission field in your call. And what is true of us as individuals is also true of us as congregations. Calling is not just discovered or learned. Calling is discerned. We just don't bump into our calling. Our calling is not just given us. We discern calling. And I mean by discerning, I mean discernment is when we are directed by God with our whole being. When we are listening for God's voice, when we are experiencing God's leading, when our hearts are attuned to God's movement, when we are aware of our context and our opposition, and in all of that, we are discerning the direction of God. We're saying, Lord, lead me and guide me along the way. Lord, if you lead me, I shall not stray. It is, Lord, order my steps in your word. And it happens to us individually, but it also happens to us congregationally. We can be part of the same denomination and not be clones of one another. We got to let this idea go that every church and our denomination has to look, feel, sound, and be the same. If God has made you uniquely with your own fingerprint that you can search the entire world and there's no fingerprint like your fingerprint because there's nobody like you, then the same is true of the church, that God has made each and every individual church to be unique. That yes, we have the same mission and yes, we might share parts of our identity, but we also have a clear calling that God has made us on purpose with a purpose for a purpose. And that purpose does not have to be the same. This is at the core of what it means to be Baptist. We are not under the authority of a pope or denomination. That nobody has to come in our churches and tell us what to do or what to be. We discern as a body of Christ what the Lord is calling a local body to do. And I don't have to get mad by what you do in your church. As long as it aligns with the mission, I want you to have the DNA, the fingerprint of God's calling. We do not have to be the same. You might have devotion, and I might have praise and worship. We ain't got to be the same. Because God has made our congregations unique. There's some stuff we unite on. We unite for mission. Do you hear me? That the reason why we come together as a convention is to unite on mission. It's been that way from the very beginning. We unite for the purposes of education. We unite for the purposes of resources. We don't unite to be the same. God has not made us to be the same, and to be the same is a rejection of the uniqueness that God has given the local church. I want to challenge us today to explore the uniqueness of your congregation, to recover the mission of God. To say we're not just going to do anything. We have to align our mission with God's mission. And God's mission is for the lost. They need salvation. It's for the left out. They need a safe haven. It's for the least of these. They need social justice. That's across the board. But it's also an embracing of our unique blackness, our identity as black people in this country that respond in a faith way and in a faithful way to God's creation. But then finally, it is the clarity of the call. It is to say, Lord, we're not going to spend our time trying to be like Mount Zion, a New Hope, or El Bethel. We're going to spend our time discerning who you have called us to be. Because if God has made us on purpose, for a purpose, with a purpose, to be out of that purpose is to reject the uniqueness of God. Thank you. Thank you for your time. Tomorrow we will go into depth, Pastor Lane, about your context. We'll explore more that last piece of calling and the context that God has given you in your community. How do you know your context? How can you learn your community? How can you learn the resources that your community has? God has given you.
All things are working for my good, yeah. He's intentional, never failing. I know that all things are working for my good, yeah. He's intentional, never failing. All things are working
for my good,
'cause he's intentional.
He's intentional.
Hey. And it's never failing.
Never failing.
All things are working for my good.